And since we don't have an application, I assume that we'll reject it. So that's
Good evening. I assume everybody can hear me. As I said last night, I rarely get that complaint. Thank you for having us here tonight. I'd really like to thank you for the opportunity to once again highlight the dedication and selflessness of your Albany police officers. For tonight's purposes, I'm going to be talking about specifically our emergency services team and their training protocols and how they fit into the larger picture of our police department accomplishing its mission. The emergency services team is a specialized tactical unit in our department. It really exists to deal with high-risk incidents, and that's high-risk to our members of our department, high-risk to the community, and high-risk to the suspects involved. It involves highly trained, highly skilled, and extremely well-disciplined police tactical units to reduce the risk of injuries to those people. The goal of EST is to aid in the police department achieving its mission. It augments all of our operations, and it also, in addition to Albany, it assists us with surrounding municipalities that request our support for tactical response. The emergency services team was created about 25 years ago, and it was to handle these types of critical incidents that we're reading about in the papers every day. And they're dedicated to use when there is a great risk of serious physical injury or death to citizens, police officers, and suspects within the city of Albany. The team is equipped with tactical resources and training that enable an effective response that saves lives. Since its inception, the team has responded to hundreds of critical incidents and that have spanned throughout the entire state. The team currently has a strength of 21 part-time members with an authorized strength of 25. It also has an attachment of 4 medics from the fire department. Each of these members are volunteers. This is not their full-time position. This is not what they do as a member of our department full-time. These are volunteer positions who take it upon themselves to go above and beyond and put themselves in danger. Emergency services training. Officers are selected for the emergency services team are required to complete a mandatory Department of Criminal Justice services, 160-hour basic school. In addition to that, every year, based on our own policies, they have to complete another 232 hours of training. To get onto the team initially is a 4-week rigorous school that really pushes the applicants beyond their mental and physical limits. We normally lose up to half the candidates at that school. It covers numerous topics, including legal issues, operations, less than lethal munitions, firearms, tactical medical first aid, land navigation, management of critical incidents. This team trains with the most current tactics and technologies. These tactics and technologies have enabled our team to defuse numerous violent situations without incident. It protects the lives of our citizens, it protects the lives of our officers, and it has saved the lives of many of our offenders. Let's talk about reality-based training. Reality-based training creates scenarios that enable members to function in a manner in which perishable skills can be transferred to the actual execution of life-saving tactics. These scenarios are created from real-life incidents that have occurred. So when you see one of these things occur somewhere across the country or across the state, we replicate those so we can ensure that we're ready in case that happens here. This allows us to test our tactics and our protocols, and we learn what works, where our critical needs are, and where we need more training. Reality-based training allows team members to work through their individual physiological and psychological responses to stressors that occur during real critical incidents. And why is this important? It's important because understanding how people will react through a training mechanism will allow them to save lives when the situation is real. This is from some of the leaders in training, and they talk about when they combine proper concepts, tactics, and strategies with the ability to manage the body's normal and natural responses to a stressful event, we have a formula for success. Let's talk about the recent training exercise. This recent training exercise took place on Thursday, March 21st. It took place on the front porch and inside of one apartment scheduled for demolition. It started around noon, and the actual training lasted approximately 2 hours. Notifications were made on Tuesday evening when emergency no parking placards were posted and the walkway entrances to the areas were taped off. Notifications included notifying residents during the posting of the upcoming training. There was no systematic method of notification. The training exercise consisted of 7 actual members involved in the scenario. There were 5 team members that were observing the scenario. There were additionally 5 safety officers deployed wearing bright yellow marked safety vests. And we had 4 individual officers involved as role players. Additionally, there was a large APD training in progress sign at the entrance of the parking lot. This sign is approximately a 4x4 sign that says exactly that, APD training in progress. Police tape and safety officers were assigned to all the entrances to the area where this training was taking place. There was no live ammunition on the site. We only utilized simunitions during the scenario. Not so easy to see this. This is the area in which we did the training. The blue lines indicate, the blue line at the entrance to the parking lot indicates where.
We could dim the lights for this if you would, just for a moment. Could you turn off the lights so people can see what there is? Thank you.
The blue line at the entrance to the parking lot is where that large sign was placed. So you could clearly see if you were passing by on the street that was a training exercise. The highlighted areas up at the top are where the yellow tape was placed to prevent anybody from wandering into the training exercise. The pink lines along the rooftops are vacant buildings. The green circles are where all the clearly marked safety officers were placed. The red line is where the training took place on the right-hand side of the screen. No, I'll ask him to go back. The training utilized a small explosive charge on an apartment door. This was not used to breach the door. It had no. It was used as a simulation of what we would have to do if we had to actually knock the door off, and it was tantamount to a firecracker. Inside the apartment, we used a minimal amount of aerosol irritant to simulate had the need to gas the apartment. This was, as opposed to being deployed normally through a shotgun type instrument, it was hand deployed through a window. There was nowhere near enough to permeate any of the locations. In fact, it didn't even make it outside the apartment itself. And this is a normally used in our training and tactical deployment of these types of agents. The Albany Police Department Emergency Services team has trained in over 100 different locations, some on multiple days. In fact, I believe the number in the last 14 years is 105. And I'm going to show you where they are on the following maps. Nationally, not the easiest thing to see, and it's not going to be easier if we turn the lights down. It's mostly centered on the state of New York, but we've been in Nevada, Tennessee, I believe, and a couple of other places around D.C., but mostly New York. Can you go to the next map? This is New York State. These are all the places that we have done training around New York State. As you can see, we've made our way around some of the surrounding regions. Can you go to the next region? Next slide. This is our region, goes far beyond Albany County to show where we've done our training. And this is the city of Albany. And each of those stars is a place where we have done training. As you can see, there is not a spot in the city of Albany, a ward in the city of Albany, where this type of training has not occurred. As a result of issues that have occurred as a result of this last training, which is the first time we have ever encountered this type of incident, this type of reaction. We are in the process of finalizing some guidelines to address our training at off-site locations. What we're looking to do is we're actually going to implement a notification procedure. We have not had a notification procedure in any of our previous trainings over the past 25 years. However, in light of some of the responses we have, we recognize that a better notification is necessary. We are going to talk to the surrounding community about the specifics on the type of training that is taking place. We're going to create a mechanism for community input on the training that we will be conducting. And we're going to have a written memorandum of agreement specifying the responsibilities of all appropriate parties. Bottom line, our training is about saving lives. If you wouldn't mind, we have just a quick video. The picture you see in front of you is our emergency services team, a team I'm very proud of and a good representation of our department. Lately, they've been characterized as a military arm of our department. What you have there are husbands, fathers, and sons who put themselves in harm's way. And they're a good representative of the type of first responders that we have in this region. I'd like to thank them on behalf. That's all I have.
Thank you. You talked about an aerosol version. Was it the same kind of material that would have been used if it had been an actual situation, just less of it?
That's exactly it.
And you talked about how you're going to institute training guidelines that include notification procedures. My understanding is that, and I'm sure the housing authority can contribute to this too, my understanding is that the police department was going to take responsibility for notification?
Within the complex itself, there was apparently a little bit of miscommunication considering we don't normally notify people.
Right.
However, the officer did take it upon himself to make notifications. He dealt with a few people that were outside at the time. However, most of the apartments, as you can see in the complex, were vacant. The surrounding ones where we did all our work were, except for the ones on the top of the hill. We should have done a better job of making that communication. And as we go forward, in recognition of the mistake that we made, we are going to make sure when we do these types of trainings that everybody in the area is notified and has some comments, some contribution as to whether or not they want these things occurring in their neighborhood. I'll say as an aside, I have had an outpouring of people and places, not only in the city of Albany, but in the entire region, actually as far away as Schoharie, that have offered up opportunities for us to do to do our training. And so I'm less than pleased that we have set some people. Looks like it has afforded us other opportunities.
When you have done other trainings, because you showed us a map of many places in the city of Albany where trainings have been previously conducted, were there people nearby when you did those trainings as well, and were they as near as people were that might be around?
There are many places on there. I can tell you for sure that there were places that we were just in the same proximity.
Okay. Well, I've heard about the Marshall's training. Is that the one that you're referring to?
No, there were numerous trainings that went on in those abandoned buildings in between the time when people were moved out and March 21st.
Right. Okay, I don't have anything.
I've seen routine in action. Staff from a dress code had passed the situation. I saw the training going into action. I was very impressed with what I was in which I was to be a younger officer then. As a person, that they were training well. I hope they keep training. I don't know how you're going to train them. You're a plus to what we need around here. My daughter was living in Boston the last couple of days. Touched my heart, I had tears in my eyes. And it's needed. I read everything that pops up on Facebook, news break today, whatever. It's happening all over. Right? We need it. I think the community has to say. We have to find a place, how it's done, how it's done properly. And she spoke last time, communication is proper. Right? We've done it many times before, it hasn't been found. And one thing has slipped up, whatever. It's important. It's more important now than it ever has been before. And I feel, one question I do have is, the person came up here, 232 hours training. I'm not sure if that's, it can't be per team, it's going to be per member. That's a lot of training for the number of officers, they're always called soldiers themselves, and today's war, they're not a soldier, we're going to say, that's a lot of manpower to whatever, and, you know, if we don't stay staffed, that's a concern that we have to stay staffed, we're going to do that training, and we do have to do that training, so. It's just, you know, I'm kind of lucky this. You know, an hour ago, I got a phone call, you know, FBI arrested somebody in Boston, and a small law, I heard that phone question. It's important to me, it's important to everybody here, the training has to be done, has to be proper, and it's just a matter of communicating to people, but it just has to be, that's the world that we live in. And let's do it properly, let's do a proper notification, because I think we're all the same way, but and yesterday brought about, and that's all I have to say.
Chief, I believe you said that one of the problems was there was no systematic method of notification when you were working now on a systematic method of notification. When you get that done in a protocol or whatever, do you run a class to start?
Of course. There is it's probably a good time to talk about something that we've recently embarked on over the last several months. We have begun our reassessment of our entire standard operating procedure. We are seeking an international standard through FOLIA, which is going to bring us beyond our current level of accreditation with New York State, which is approximately 150 points. It's going to be 480 of the best practices that we recognize nationally and internationally. So that's something we started working on about a month ago, and it's something we're looking forward to completing. It's going to be a long process, and we're looking forward to some help from very people in this room.
And you did show us that, and I mean, first of all, it's a good idea to be working with other police departments in a multi-county area, because I assume maybe they're also supporting in cases of major emergencies. But I was looking at the map of Albany, which you showed. Some of them were closer than I did, but I don't recall the use of any kind of rear end gas or pyrotechnics act or something. I know, for example, you did one at the traffic police building, which is not demolished, and I think that was just a retaliation of other kinds of things. I don't remember any of these gas pyrotechnics.
We've used both all over the city and all over the region. You wouldn't know if we were using small amounts of gas. There'd be no way for you to know if it's like someone smoking a cigarette. So you wouldn't know about that. And as I said, the explosives that we use are just a training mechanism, a signal. Okay, you hear that noise, that means the door would be off. Well, the door is not off because we basically use fire pressure. So you wouldn't necessarily know that these things have gone on.
Granted, the buildings where you did the exercises were vacant, but were some people restricted in neighboring buildings that people did live in? Were they restricted from entering, leaving, not knowing in advance?
No one was allowed to enter the training area that was taped off 48 hours prior to our training and during the training. In fact, during the training, there was one individual that wanted to walk through, was fairly insistent on walking through. The training was stopped several times, at which point he was asked not to enter the training area. He was not given access to that area.
But was anybody restricted from their house or in there or into their house?
No.
Because of the exercise?
No.
Other questions from committee members? What is the role of U.S. Marshals in those things? Because you have necessarily mentioned in this particular training, there's, photographical evidence that somebody wearing U.S. Marshals insignia was present. So what is the role of U.S. Marshals in these trainings and how? Are agencies involved in this training, such as FBI and others?
Who
state Boston's that you have been in?
The U.S. Marshals were not involved in our training, and there were no other departments involved in this training.
They never involved in this thing?
105 trainings. I have no idea. We may have. We work with Troy. We work with Colony. We work with the Albany County Sheriff. We work, of course, with our fire department. The state police. So we do work with many other agencies. Your question was regarding the evidence you apparently have. You are mistaken, and we were not training with the U.S. Marshals.
What is the timeline for the developing standard that you just said, particularly for this type of thing?
We are working as we speak on the notification piece because we can't hold up training for our CLIA standards. But I don't see that being too long term. We already have the draft put together. We'll have to sit down with the Corporation Council to make sure it meets their muster. And then we can share it with you to see what your thoughts are on it.
Who are the involved parties in the memorandum of understanding?
It would have to be the people that have that are party that have an interest in the event. In this situation, it would have been us and the Housing Authority and have a written memorandum of understanding of what everybody's responsibilities are, so we can spell out who's responsible for notifying the community, who's responsible for insurance, those types of things. And while we have had some basic level of that, we are going to formalize that.
So it would be on the same timeline, so would you say that in 2 months, 3 months, is that?
I don't think it'll take that long.
Okay. And so the council will be shared, you will share that information.
I'd like your input.
Okay. On the review of standard operating procedures and the training, I have previously requested specifically standard operating procedures on the use of NVE, since it is related to training, or the use of taser by the Albany Police Department, and that's something that I can yet receive, and I'd like to receive a copy of that so that I can review it as a member of the council. I have received the standard operating procedures on the script storage and was SOPs were very, very heavily adapted. Probably 3 paragraphs in a 5-page document that I could read. So that doesn't necessarily help.
It
relates to standard operating procedures and training by the police department.
Always try to tie everything back to something that's been redacted, okay? Because you don't get it, and they redact because they don't want to give out some procedures for you for certain reasons. So they want for this.
We're talking about transparency, and we're talking about the review of as a member of the committee. One of the things that I feel I should have access to is the because this committee has oversight over police department. As a council member and as a member of the committee, I don't feel that the standard operating procedures that I should have access to review the standard operating procedures.
Could I just say, Ms. Antonio, your view is not whether it's shared by this committee. And as Councilmember Heigl has said, it's really not on topic. Not only do we need transparency for the police department, we also need security. We have a situation, you know, that we're watching in Boston right now. They're not telling us members of the public everything they know, and probably there are council members in the city of Boston who don't know everything they know either. Because in order to have effective protection and safety for human beings, there are times when information cannot be bandied about and sent out like a Facebook post. So the thing is, I agree with Councilmember Igo, I would like us to move on to to talking about issues that are relevant to this particular notice meeting, which is about the training, training activity.
Well, that is fine. Members of the Congress could be briefed on the nuclear weapons and the standard operating procedures, but then the council members should be able to receive non-redacted documents. On the training and relating to training and standard operating procedures that are used by the police. And that, I understand that the chairwoman doesn't share my belief in that this is something that's not violating any security issues, and that there should be some transparency in the standard operating procedures.
How do you know it's not? I'm just curious. Let me ask you, you're making a statement as if you know for a fact. How do you know it's not, it doesn't risk any sort of security? What are you basing that on?
How would, when you're supposed to turn on and not supposed to turn on cameras and police cars, violate
different topic. Different topic.
I asked you a question. I'm asking you a question. You are claiming that there's no security risk, Councilman. Explain that. How do you know that there's no risk to security based on that? I'd like to know the answer to that.
Well, it's not. It's there is no clear procedures that could be viewed. How could I know one way or another?
Well, I'm going to suggest that we move on. Do you have any other questions relevant to this topic?
Yeah. I'm sorry, I'm just going to show you. On top of it, okay, and considering training, and then everything's happening in our country today. Every time you turn on the television, it's like 10 years ago. Some pros, some cons, say whatever, do the front listen. But I was impressed by, and I had a training. You talked about, you had everybody up there, the governor, the mayor, JTTF. Which I just presume joint task force or whatever, terrorists or they had training. They all worked together. They had to work together. If God forbid that Boston Marathon to fly off a run on a smaller scale, right? I just want to be reassured that you are in training with the state police, the FBI, the ATF, whatever, right? I don't want to do that for them. That's what reassures me. What I saw there, I want to see it. What I've seen done, I've been impressed by, that's what reassures me and the people that I talk to. Not the redacted things you can't let out and this and that. That's what I want to know. That's what my constituents want to know. We want to know what we believe, okay, that you prepare for. That's what I want to know. That's, and you know whether it takes the vacant home at this time, or what is vacant, or some apartment, somehow, someplace, that training has to proceed. Well, I don't care if you, we know this whole area and state, we build an area, whatever it is, and we're going to, that has to be done. We have to be prepared for that. That's all I care about, okay? You know what? What it can be done properly with communications and neighbors in there? That's right. All right? And I want it to be done. It's going to be, it just has to be done in the proper way. All right?
And I think that the police department has acknowledged that this could have been done in a much more effective fashion as far as not alarming and scaring people who live in Ida Yarbrough. Ida Yarbrough is my ward. And I certainly feel protective of everyone and everything that's in my ward. So the thing is that, you know, we're talking about balancing that.
Yes.
And we're also talking about communications and effective communication. And, you know, we don't want to have people alarmed, upset, and traumatized as police learn how to or keep their skills at the highest level for saving lives. Those don't have to be competing interests. I think you agree with that. I would like to I would like to hear from
Mr. Igor interrupted me.
Excuse me, I'm going to go on.
I'm sorry, but I respond to Mr. Ida because he was responsive to me. You know, one of the things that I understand that there's certain things that security is important, and I understand that. But for the sake of my constituents, I want to make sure that security is not used, and security concerns are not used to violate any of the rights of my my constituents.
Can I just interrupt? At council meetings, we don't have those kinds of responses. I'm sorry. So let's just continue.
And the reason I'm asking for standard operating procedures is that because it should be clear to me and to everybody that what's right are never going to be violated, and that it is very clear what happens when and the police is trained properly, what happens when somebody is stopped, and when is it appropriate to use taser, when is it not appropriate to use taser. It's a topic of training, Madam Chair, Chairwoman, meeting was very clearly noticed as to pertain to trainings, particularly. I am concerned that people of the members of the force are trained and how they are trained, and I think that the public should know what things, and they should be assured that their rights are not going to be violated for the sake of security or any other reasons. That's why I have my position. And I'm sure I understand that they're not shared by everybody.
Yes, Madam President.
First of all, I'd just like to thank Mr. Green, your chief and deputy chief, to hear what not only the council members have to say, but what the public has to say. And, you know, I just want to echo the comments that we want to make sure that any procedures that you undertake do not jeopardize people, not even just not jeopardize them, but don't frighten them. And that's what happens here. And I think we've all owned up to what mistakes that were made. And I'm looking forward to hearing this agreement that is being worked out with your department, the Housing Authority, and with the help of the NAACP to ensure the residents of public housing that they won't experience this type of activity again. But another thing that is important to me is that as it relates to training, you know, as you go forward with training, that we take steps to ensure that any training encompasses the whole cultural competency that we've talked about in the past. And I know that you we've been encouraged by the work that you have done, and look forward to conversation with them around this training and the possibility of it taking place. They maybe could have advised you differently in terms of communicating with people, or maybe this is not the place that you want to do it. But I know that, you know, we've been very excited about that board since it came into fruition, and I would just like to see you utilize them more as you continue your community policing efforts and building that bridge between the department and the community. I believe it has worked very well thus far, and that's just a recommendation that I have, that you would truly use them as an advisory board on when you have to make decisions such as this.
President? Chief had a great meeting last night at PAC, at the Hibernian Hall, and everybody agreed. Everybody agreed that communication was the problem. Okay. Doing everything in their power. At PAC, somehow we have to figure out for those people, they all agree amongst themselves and the people in there, but to get that greater message out. That's the problem, and that's what it comes down to tonight. Everything here, Chief, some of that is communication. People have great ideas. So, you know, that's it. And you know what? Chief says, technology, we've got to get out there. But it's communication is the problem. You know what? There's been three meetings with this chief, all right? See, it takes a big man to say, he's wrong, and we sorry. Okay? We've all learned from our mistakes. He admits that, we're all trying, all want to work together. I don't want this man, this department, to be hammered for something that was, you know, everybody's at fault. You know? Well, the backpack is clearly, not the residents, but it's all communication, it's all of us here. And that's what it takes to go forward, and he's trying.
Just to clarify, backpack is the Albany Community Police Advisory Committee. It has been in place for at least 3 years. And we have the chair of that committee, Beverly Cabot here. And I'm not sure, and I think some other members here as well. So that's just a point of information. Council members, do other council members have questions for you?
No, I just want to say, Chair, I appreciate the work you do with the department list. I appreciate your responses to community concerns. And I think you've also ushered in an atmosphere of working together where I think we all learn together. I think you are sensitive to issues in regards, especially with regard to citizen rights and civil rights, et cetera. So, I think this experience was good, learning experience, some issues to address. I'm looking forward to seeing the notification procedures put in place. But it's all, this is a conversation you probably would, the tenor of the conversation we would have had a couple of years ago if it had happened would have been very different, the difference from what happened today. And I really appreciate that.
Albert? Yes?
Yeah, just to go back to that, the notices that were posted of the emergency walking signs, that was on the Tuesday, 2 days or a day and a half, for the Thursday activities. And when was the sign put there about APD training activity? Was that just the other day? Put it on Thursday?
It was contemporaneous with the training. It's something they bring with them.
So it was an electronic sign saying that on such and such a day, Tuesday, taking on Thursday, what the date was.
No.
So we didn't have any of that kind of one.
This was a little bit of a surprise to us.
Again, we have
25 years of training, and we've never had this kind of response. We do now. We learn from the response, and we move forward to make sure we don't have this kind of issue again.
And I just want to get the days there, so looking ahead of the policy coming up with that. Emergency no parking signs. A sign of point. As you know, suggestions not really long. But, and I don't know what the time would be for the signs and the training starting on Thursday, but I don't know. But that would affect the training either. People know that ahead of time. So, and then the other thing is with the, and some of the things I heard that night, discussing my actions on the next night, the Thursday, next Friday. People said me were concerned that we said, the map show they've done this in other places. I mean, yes, the people were around and notified, but and nobody had a housing authority conference, the major conference with a lot of people. I mean, we did one, a person Andrew, a person Andrew. You're not having the concentration of people in one spot, and you also don't have the history of violence and gun violence and shots fired. And things going on that people are very sensitive to. And then when they hear this thing that they weren't aware of the training, having had people shot around the point from my house a couple times in the last year, does tend to make you a little on edge when something like that is going on. So you understand when some of the people are coming in and sending things, emailing and Facebook and things to me about that. And that's what a lot of it had to do with. The fear because of the situation for living already. Even though I think a lot of that violence is going down, way down. It's still there, it's going back to the mind. When they do hear, something that sounds like a firecracker or something, like a gunshot. But it will be on a better notification system.
So, this moment, a little bit of a specific here. How many people actually? With the complaints or were actually negatively impacted by this training exercise? How many complaints were actually handled?
I don't know that we have that information. There are several people who I'm aware of from having gone to numerous community meetings since this occurred. There are several people who have been upset by it. I don't think any formal complaints have been filed so that you could actually count them. But I am personally aware, having gone to, as I said, a number of these meetings and having arranged where some of the meetings actually to occur. And this might be a good point to mention that with the input and cooperation of the Housing Authority and the Police Department, there will be a provision of trauma conference services starting at Ida Yarbrough on Saturday, I believe, this Saturday is the 20th, I think it is. And that will go on. There are four different times that are scheduled. This counseling, trauma counseling, will be delivered by professionals who are familiar with the community and crime victims and sexual assault county office. They're involved with it, as are some other entities and agencies. So, in some ways, that's a reverse answer or whatever to what you were asking. There's an understanding that people have been traumatized and that making those services available is critical for us to do. And as I said, with cooperation among the agencies, it will indeed occur. So we might, you know, I don't know if that information would ever be shared as to how many people avail themselves of it, but that would be a way in some sense to answer the question that you have.
And then when's the police running the training session become aware that there was a problem with this notification problem? Was it just afterwards all completed at some point, or was it during the training when the person people came around and said that they were, you know, surprised or complaining about it at that time, in real time?
I received a phone call on Saturday night.
After the training, yes. And my final question is that didn't the training hours that you mentioned there was 282 a year for the certification here? It seems like a lot of hours. I mean, so the frequency of this training has been, I would say, relatively high. I mean, fair to say that training is taking place on a weekly basis throughout the city?
It takes place, it depends on what role you play, but at bare minimum, it's 2 days a month.
The training would be going on, telling you. Training's going on all the time in the city, I mean, essentially.
Not always in the city.
Oh, no, okay.
But there is, at bare minimum, 2 days a month in that specific training.
Thank you.
Councilman Bailey.
Chief, thank you for coming. As we've been through this, one of the things that we did learn that the police needs to train, especially with the way the world is today. And we have noticed that the main problem that happened was the communication breakdown. So, and just picking back off what the president said, that better communication, working with the board members, is a basic people. Maybe next time we won't have to go to the office. You know,
I'm sure we won't.
Yeah. And, you know, as I was watching some of those pictures up there, we were talking about Trustful Bank and stuff. Kind of like took me back because I remember the Trustful Bank one on State Street. Because I remember they thought my cousin Herman was in there. And he was over on Morton Avenue. My whole family was out there worried about officers going in there getting him. Because it turned out he was in another area with somebody else that looked like him. And stuff, and also the Westerlo Street, where the hostages were held in there. And the officers did an excellent job bringing everybody else safe. You know, even the sale, you know. So communication is the main part. You know, we all know that the officers get a training. We know that we live in a wicked world today. You know, this is what happened with in Boston. You know, so communication, that's what we got to work on. Thank you for your service.
If no other members have an opportunity,
just one more question for the public, so you know, put it into perspective. The reader, I think some people, a lot of people don't know, she called the yard, I didn't know, to, you know, geographic dimensions of it, okay? How how much is being torn down and where. And we saw here the different buildings where it was. But geographically, it was the whole community. You know what I'm saying? They think it was just like a run rampant throughout this whole thing. It was an isolated part, most of it, that was being ready for demolition. It wasn't run throughout the whole place.
But it was close in the turnaround.
And I don't know if you geographically you see something. I don't know the whole geographics, all right? And that, it could be more disturbing one way or the other for people to have, because I believe it's a certain part. Ida Yarbrough and Steve, when he comes up, it, you know, set for demolition to be rebuilt or whatever. Wasn't the whole thing running rampant, as you said?
No, they're not running everywhere.
No, but some people try to give them impression.
Okay, no,
and I do not believe that, and I just want to put that point across.
No, they were not running everywhere. The point is that there were people who resided there during the year. So they were not over.
But there were two different.
Yeah, I've knocked on virtually every door, and Ida Yarbrough, each one, clearly. And a few weeks ago after it happened, I drove around to look and see where fences were, where buildings are very clearly vacated, and they're getting, you know, they're closer to being demolished. So I went and looked at it, you know, and no, it was not the entire complex, but indeed, the entire complex. Quite large.
Yeah, well, no, that's what I'm saying. Some people think it's just like, you know, this Ida Yarbrough is like a whole place. I just want to make it clear that it's not that.
Okay. I think that we have concluded with our discussion with you. And
I do appreciate everything you do and the community policing and everything. So just to make it very clear that just because I ask questions doesn't mean that I don't appreciate what you're doing, what you have done, and the direction the police has taken overall, and everything that you do and every officer does. I just like to take a look at some of the procedures and the transparency for the training, that's all I'm asking for, just for some information and the ease to getting that information, because it's some information I've been asking for that it's apparently not that easy to get.
Can I respond?
Sure.
I'm sure you think I shouldn't. We have good relationships with the council, this police department, and when any issue goes on in any ward throughout the city, my phone rings immediately. And we talk, we figure out what the issue is, questions are asked, answers are given, and we work through the problems. The only one I get emails from, or used to get emails from, are you. And they're riddles, they're not questions. What I would ask from you is if you are truly looking for information, that you either go, you shouldn't have to go through the FOIL procedure. I don't think anybody here has ever gone through the FOIL procedure as long as I've been the chief of police. Ask us what you're actually at. Look, what are you looking for? When you're asking for something, ask for something that exists. Now, I'm going to give you an example, the taser policy. When the NYCLU wanted our taser policy, they got it. Unredacted, they have our policy. So I don't know why you have a redacted policy, but it would just take a phone call to me to ask for these things, and I will make sure they're available to you. I can't do that for everybody all over the city and state and country that wants information. They're going to have to deal with the FOIL, but being in the position that you are with the Common Council, we should have that type of relationship. We just saw each other at Somos. We were in the same elevator. You could have asked me at that time, hey, Chief, I am looking for this information. What's the deal? Why is it being held up? But you didn't. You don't even give me the opportunity. So I ask going forward that we have that type of relationship. So if you're looking for something, you get it, because that is my job.
Thank you. Okay, pardon me? You. Oh, you're allowed to do it. Okay, thank you so much for coming in, and longer.